Hey guys, welcome to the Kane Audio Vlog. It's Friday again, so it's time for another Ask Me Anything. Usual rules apply. Comment anything you want below this video and I'll get to you answering it in next week's video. Before I go on to last week's questions, house admin, what do I need to mention? What have I been doing this week? I've been working on a few more remixes. Those of you who follow me on Facebook, Instagram and all of that, you'll have probably heard a couple of teaser clips being put out. One of them is a remake of an old classic. And I really just did it for, I've got a few gigs coming up at festivals this summer, so I wanted something to sort of smash out in those. One of them I actually really like, I think I've done a really good job with it. So I've now contacted the original publishers and I'm going to see if I can get permission to release that as a new track. Who knows, wish me luck on that, because last time I did that, I won't mention what track it was because it ended up accidentally getting released on white label on vinyl back in the day. The original artists, by the way, just before anyone starts talking about the legalities of that, basically I did a rework of an old track. It got played by Pete Tong and a few others on Radio 1, so it gathered a lot of publicity, and the original artists then got in touch with me saying, we love it, we think you should release your own version. Here's the name of our publishers. I went to the publishers and I won't mention their names, but they're a bunch of bastards, and I think they wanted something like 20 grand and 90% royalties or something like that, which was just crazy at the time. So I remember I had my distributors, because I was running a record label on vinyl at the time, and the distributors accidentally pressed 10,000 copies onto vinyl. So if you have a copy of that vinyl, you are one of 10,000 people on earth. And in fact, I've got probably 10 of them. So there we go. Anyway, I digress. So I'll be chasing that up. Who knows how long it'll take. But if you're following me on any upcoming gigs or whatever, then listen out for those. What else? There are more remixes. Unfortunately, I've done a bunch of remixes this year, and I've not really got official release dates for any of them, so I'm not announcing anything because I don't know what order they're coming out or anything like that. So, and obviously, I only want to focus on one at a time. Other than that, I can't think of anything else that needs mentioning. No, I think that's it. Right, let's get on. Right, starting at the top. Ricky John, command, high five. Happy Friday, Dom. Bit of a last minute question, but it's only just come to me as I finally had a free morning to get stuff done. How do you go about having a consistent sound with regards to EPs? I'm sure you've said you do this. Do you think anyone cares if you use obviously very similar samples / sounds? I have a theme and that's helped a lot, but I find straying too far from a particular set of sounds makes it all seem less together. Yeah, that's kind of a tricky one because, well, starting as an EP, so let's say you got between three and five tracks or something, I suppose, is the average EP. It's really a personal choice. I don't think anyone cares if they sound totally different. But if they're going to sound the same and you're sticking to a theme, then I think you need to try and change something else. So, you know, a lot of you will know that I guess a lot of my tracks sound probably quite similar, very similar, I suppose, to some people over the last few years. And I do kind of struggle with that, but I kind of have some sounds that I guess I'm kind of known for, I suppose, certainly with like the big bassy leads. But within those leads I also use very specific techniques of things like reverbs and delays and send channels and stuff like that, so I also kind of mirror, if I'm not going to mirror the sound, I'll mirror the technique, so there's still I guess that, you know, if you look at my last Structures EP, there were four tracks on that. Topology, Structures, Susumi and Compound. Yeah, four tracks. And each of them share sounds, but I hope they sound somewhat different. And I guess that's really where you then have to change things up is if you're going to use the same sounds, you've got to change the vibe of the track. So like Topology, for example, was really stripped back, minimal, melodic techno, I guess. Whereas Susumi was a bit more, a bit richer and a bit deeper, and a more uplifting melody. Whereas Structures was kind of a combination of those, of both of those. It had a very uplifting melody, but was quite driving in between the melodies. And then the last one, Compound, was just a lot more upbeat and up-tempo. So the whole vibe of each track is kind of different. And part of the reason for that is that if I was going to play all four of those tracks in a DJ set, in a gig, and to be fair, if I'm a headline act in a nightclub, you know, most of the people who are in that club are there to see me play my music. I don't want to be playing four of essentially the same track, so I'll kind of write an EP with that in mind. It's not essential, but it's something I have in mind, is that if I'm going to play a set and play two, three or four of those tracks, then I want them to be in different places in my set, and my set will probably be somewhat of a journey, I suppose, for lack of a better word. So I kind of need them to be in different placements. About consistency, it's a really fine line between being consistent and being boring for me. And I struggle with that daily, I think. So I try to keep everything consistent in terms of sound design, but where I try to change it up is more in the vibe of the track or the style of the track, or maybe the emotion of the melody or something like that. I'll try and sort of switch up a bit. I guess that's where you've got to, you know, you can't have both being repeated, because otherwise you're just rewriting the same track over and over again. The last thing then I'll mention on that is in terms of sound design. So you mentioned samples/sounds. So I would never use the same samples twice unless it's a hi-hat or something, but when it comes to sounds, and I've said many times before that, you know, pretty much all of my signature sounds I redesign or reshape or rebuild in some way, so it's ever so slightly different in every track. So if, for example, you were to compare the lead sound in any of my releases, even though it's still very similar, to the more astute people, you'll notice it's just not ever quite the same twice. And the reason for that is because when I'm using the Moog, for example, I don't save a preset. You know, I'll write the track, get it how I want it, delete the preset, gone. and then if I want to ever do that sound again, I just have to start from scratch. And part of that is because I like the creative process of that. And part of it is because I don't want it to just be using the same preset. I don't want making music to be boring. And I think we as artists have to remember that we're not making art to please other people. That's an added bonus. Or certainly from my perspective, I don't make music to try and make other people happy. I hope that it does make other people happy, and I hope that other people enjoy my music, but that's not the reason I write it. The reason I write it is to express my emotion at that time, or to just enjoy the experience of making a track at the time. So I think that's really important as well. Cavalcade. In the process of packing to move house this week. Ugh. So no question from me, but I enjoyed watching. Cheers and command. High five. P.S. The Stuart Lee recommendation isn't coincidence. Google is listening. Yeah, it's probably also the fact that I watch a hell of a lot of Stuart Lee. So it will always keep recommending more. Yeah, well, good luck with the house move, because I know that's hell on earth, even if it's going well. Cake C. Hey Dom, thanks for the videos again, sir. I was wondering what would be good ADSR settings on your master's compressor for techno, electro, house at 128 BPM. Okay, also, so ADSR setting on master, oh, on compressor, right. Also, you spoke about Beyer Dynamic headphones. I was wondering what headphones you recommend or really enjoy listening to and which ones would be the closest to actually be able to mix on. Cheers. So I'll cover the headphones thing while I also save that because I'm working on a track at the moment. How's that? Open up that. So the headphones bit is kind of tricky because, so first of all, if you're genuinely wanting to do professional mixdowns and masters on headphones, you need to be spending thousands. And so just for clarity, I'm not going into that because I don't mix a master on headphones, nor do I ever want to. So I've never spent thousands. So if you're looking for top of the range stuff, I'm not the guy to recommend them to you. However, I have DT770 Pros here, which are my go-to headphones. I've got some 880s as well somewhere. In fact, that shows what I think are the 880s. They're not even unpacked. They're still boxed from when I moved into this temporary room. Maybe that says all you need to know. You mentioned Beyer Dynamic. You didn't give a number. Right, so for me, the 770 Pros are the ones for me. I went for the high ohm models because you can get different ohms, which is the resistance of the headphones. The higher the ohmage, if that's a word, the better the quality, but you need a separate headphone amplifier once you get to a certain level. If I'm completely and utterly honest, I did try some low ohmage 770s compared to these after I'd bought them. A friend of mine came round and had the exact same model but lower ohmage, and I really couldn't tell much difference other than the lower ohmage went louder on a smaller amplifier. So I think, again, you know, if you're talking about mixing and mastering on headphones, which is something I never recommend to people to do because I do think there are disadvantages to that, but I also fully understand that not everyone can afford a fully acoustically treated studio with decent monitor speakers and whatever, so work with what you've got. So go for the higher ohmage ones if you can afford them with a good quality headphone amp. Otherwise, you're not losing huge amounts. I mean, like I say, we're talking low budget anyway. I think they're like £100-150 for a set of headphones, something like that. I can't remember. But we're not talking crazy money, so really it's up to you on the ohmage. And the other question you asked, I've been loading something in the background, which was just a recent mix and master I did. And you wanted to know settings. I'll be honest with you, I use a bunch of different compressors and it kind of changes each time when it comes to a master. But I can tell you here on a drum bus, I've got a release of 52 milliseconds, so it's pretty snappy. And the attack of 2.2 milliseconds, so it's very snappy. But that's really because it's tightening up the drums. That's the wrong one. Does that even have? No, because that's attenuation. Another one I'm using here, so that was the UAD Precision Channel Strip, which I really like as a drum bus. Then over here I've got on the master channel, this is the first compressor in the master, and it is the TDR Kotelnikov by Tokyo Dawn Labs. I use this as a fairly gentle, I think I have it on automatic release, no I don't. Release RMS, 200 milliseconds, release peak, 60 milliseconds. So they've got, that's got two different release times. You've got release peak and release RMS. So release peak, 60 milliseconds, pretty sharp. Release RMS is 200 milliseconds, just so it's a smoother. So it'll tighten up on the peaks, but it'll also not loosen up too much, if that makes any sense whatsoever. And the attack is 7 milliseconds, and it's an early compressor in the chain. So yeah, that's, I don't know if that helps you, but that's what my settings are on my latest release. I don't tend to look too much into it unless I think this might be a bit controversial, but when it comes to compressor settings, unless you're hearing the pumping effect of a compressor, then you've probably got it all right, you know. And I don't go for huge gain reduction amounts in my compressors either, so really the attack and release times aren't quite as important when you're only doing, say, you know, a dB, maybe 2 dB at the very most of gain reduction. And the reason I do that is because I'll stage up maybe 3 or 4 different compressors at different stages, pre and post, to EQ. It sounds like someone's drilling next door. I don't know if you can hear that. So apologies for that. Then finally, the last thing in the chain, other than meters and stuff like that, the last active thing, I highly recommend NuGen Audio ISL2, which is a true peak limiter. And on that, it's got a look ahead of 2 milliseconds. Release time is auto, says 12 milliseconds, but the auto bit is highlighted. And again, I look for a gain of about 0.5 dB on that. So it's pretty subtle. But for the nerdier guys of you that look into like mixing and mastering, stuff like that, I highly recommend a true peak limiter, because if you are pushing the levels a bit, and you bounce out a 16-bit 44.1K WAV and then convert it to MP3, you'll get digital clipping and inter-sample clipping. Yeah, so that's one thing to look out for. I can see there's a reply to that as well. I can recommend, this is Sunset 86, I can recommend Beyerdynamic DT770 Pro closed back headphones. That's the ones I recommended. They're affordable and look the biz and ideal for listening when mixing. I've heard the DT990 Pros are good too for open back and ideal as mix sounds wider on them. Yeah, so that's another thing I didn't mention, is closed back, open back. I actually prefer closed back, to be honest. I know open back is supposed to be a better quality sound, but I just feel that actually I think headphones need a bit of a shove when it comes to the low end, and closed back does that for me. Also, the reason I have a few sets of headphones is for when I'm working in a booth, and if I'm recording a vocalist, and you have to have closed back for that. So yeah, because obviously you don't want the music leaking into the microphone. So yeah, I agree. Sunset 86, in fact, you're next. Hey Dom, come on, high five. Got a bit of a longish question. Here we go. Since you're a sound designer, I guess you'd be the best person to ask. So here goes. I'm trying to find out how to create this specific white noise clap snare you hear in some EDM tracks over the years. I guess it's some kind of filtered noise, but I'm not sure. It kind of has a whack to it with a whip crack, if you know what I mean. The best example of the type of sound I'm aiming for can be heard on Sam Sparrow's Black and Gold. I remember the track, I don't remember the snare drum, so let me have a quick listen and turn it right down. It's a good track, I remember that track. Well, there's a couple of snares going on in there. 3, to be precise. I think you're talking about the gated reverb one. So if you Google gated reverb, it's like an 80s technique. Basically stick big, thick, rich reverb onto the snare drum and gate it so that once the reverb releases down to a certain level, it just quickly shuts off. So that's the effect that's kind of given it that white noisy effect. As for starting places with the samples, I'd probably start with a clap really quiet in the mix, and also some actual white noise, but shape it. So easiest way is probably bounce just one beat of white noise, bounce it down as audio and then re-import it, and then depending on what sampler or whatever you use, or just use the workstation itself, you know, adjust the volume so that it has a really, you know, it's at say 0 dB initially for the transient, and then instantly comes down in volume for, you know, within a few milliseconds, so it's got that sort of clicky sort of sound to it, and then drops suddenly down, maybe a bit of sustain and little to no release. You could probably do the whole thing without doing the gated reverb, just by shaping it yourself to kind of fit the BPM, and you'll need to adjust the decay and length times depending on the BPM of the track you're working. Just play it on loop and you'll move it back and forth, and you'll find there's a bit where you move it to where it suddenly it snaps with the groove of the track. Every offbeat has the exact sound I mean, but one is pitched up and the other is pitched down. I didn't hear that. What was that bit then? Right, well, they're two different snare drums if I'm in the right bit of the track I'm thinking of. Oh, over there. Oh, hang on. Alright, well, from, say, 2 minutes into the track, there's an offbeat one, if that's what you're talking about, the offbeat. That's literally just a little hiss of white noise. That's nothing more than that. There's no pitch change on that either. No, it's just, it's a what they call a psychoacoustic thing. I think you're probably hearing a pitch change slightly because it's in triplets and the rest of the music is changing with it and around it, and because white noise doesn't have a pitch, your ears are being tricked into thinking the pitch is changing with the rest of the track. If that's the one you're on about with the offbeat, that's literally just a short burst of white noise low down in the mix. I know you won't be able to play it live on next week's AMA, just did. But was hoping if you could maybe listen to the track prior beforehand to answering my question. Didn't, sorry, whoops. Sorry if that's a lot of question, and I appreciate you must be very busy, whatnot. Hope you can help push me in the right direction, especially as I'm waiting to get into analog and create the same sound using analog synths. So yeah, with an analog synth like this one, white noise oscillator, push it up. You could maybe do something with a sine... but I probably wouldn't bother. No, just use the white noise generator, and then play around with the ADSR. You basically want a really sharp attack, very quick decay down to almost nothing sustain. In fact, I'd probably, yeah, no, almost nothing sustain, not very long sustain, pretty much zero release, or, you know, tiny release. And then you probably want to look into getting gated reverb. But yeah, I think that's probably the easiest way to approach it. Thank you, Dom. Have a great weekend. P.S. Looking forward to watching future mixdown tutorials. You are welcome. Hope you have a good weekend too. And speaking of future mixdown tutorials, the Sonic Academy one might be out today. It's Friday, and I know the release on a Friday. It might be out next Friday, I think. I'll let you know either way. Yeah, moving on. In fact... I'm at 25 minutes. Yeah, just in case, I'll reset the camera now because it cuts out half an hour. So I'll see you in a second. Right, Nightquaker. Hello, Dom. I have a question. Have you ever seen someone blow up a club system with their crappy mix or something like that? Good question. I've seen a lot of crazy stuff in some very odd clubs in my time. In fact, I've spoken to a lot of other DJs who are at a similar level or above, and yeah, they all have a lot of stories. As for someone blowing up a club sound system, I've heard club sound systems give up on life. I couldn't say it was down to a crappy mix. Any decent club will have a sound engineer who's looking after the levels. Generally, mixing two tracks together will spike by, say, 3 dB if you've got everything playing at the same time. Beyond that, it doesn't matter whether your mix is good or bad. In fact, if anything, a good mix is, if they're in sync and the BPMs are perfectly matched, if anything, that's going to make it spike higher because you've got two sets of claps and kicks triggering at the same time. So if anything, it was a really bad mix and you were totally offbeat, your levels wouldn't be so bad, ironically. Or maybe that's my excuse for crappy mixing. I don't know. So I don't think I've ever seen anyone blow up a club sound system due to crappy mixes, but I have seen some crazy stuff happen in clubs. I couldn't think of one that's off the top of my head that probably is legal for YouTube, but there we go. Deadmau5, hi Dom, great video as always, pretty interesting and relaxing to watch, thank you very much. That's kind of the idea of this whole channel, is that as much as I feel like a granddad producer talking to everyone at home, hopefully you guys watching this appreciate the fact that I'm not trying to be a superstar YouTuber that's all fresh and exciting and snappy shots, and that's not the idea of this channel. And in fact, the very first video of this channel, I talk about the fact that I'm not looking to do that. Thank you very much. I have one question that I'm 50% sure someone has already asked you. Do you know what, I'm happy to get repeat questions as well on these days, because I think we're on, what was this one, Ask Me Anything 43, so we're now on Ask Me Anything 44, and I wouldn't expect, you know, most of them are at least half an hour long, so I wouldn't expect anyone to go through 22 hours of a video just to find one question. So yeah, ask away. Do you love collabs, and can we expect any collabs in near future, or you like more to do things on your own? Command, high five, and have a great weekend. You too. Yes and no. I find collaborations difficult, to be honest. I'll be upfront, I'm quite a selfish producer. And I tend to find that once I nail a melody or a drop or an obstacle in a track, I just go with it, and I can, you know, it. So, and I think most of you will probably relate to this, that, you know, you just come up with this amazing melody or this amazing sound or something just works, and all of a sudden you finish the track in like 2-3 hours and it's done, and then you're like, damn, how is that so quick? Why can't I always be like that? And it's just getting that first obstacle. So it, you know, obviously it takes days, weeks, months to get that one moment, but when that one moment happens, you can run with it. So I've started a lot of collaborations where maybe I've come up with that idea and I've sent a clip to someone and they've gone, oh yeah, great, let me join you. And if they don't finish the track in an hour, I've probably already finished it by the time they send me a clip back. So I'm kind of selfish like that. And also, I've done collaborations before where I've sent, say, half a track to someone and they've sent their bit back and I've gone, yeah, I kind of like it, and then I've gone and changed everything and just done it my way anyway, which I then feel bad about. So a lot of the collaborations I've done in the past that are available publicly that got released, I'd say for 99% of them, I did 99% of the track and just took over. And yeah, that's not me trying to blow my own trumpet, that's me saying I'm a bit selfish, and I know it's wrong, but I like things my way, the way I like it. So I do struggle with that. I have always said to people, and I get a lot of people asking me to do collaborations, and I have always said I'm always open to doing collaborations, but it needs to be the right track, the right place at the right time, and it needs to excite me. So it's kind of a tricky one, I guess. As for expecting collaborations in the near future, so I guess there's always stuff on the cards, and this is the other thing with collaborations, is of all the ones I've done, probably 70% of them don't come out, they don't get finished, and there's a lot of reasons for that. Sometimes I'll want it to go to this label, they'll want it to go to that label, and we can't decide, or maybe both labels don't want it, and then we go, well, we don't know, or maybe it just never gets finished, or there have been ones that I've done and they've been signed to a record label that maybe I wasn't particularly friendly with, and it gets stuck in a schedule for 6 months, and by which time I'll usually have written in a contract, of any of my contracts, I try and write in a clause where if you don't release it within X amount of time, then it comes back to me as a second option. The reason for that is because the industry moves so fast. We all go through moments where suddenly we develop our skills a bit further, or we maybe reinvent our style or something like that. And what I wouldn't want, and has happened in the past, where I've done a track and there's one collaboration I'm thinking of right now that went on a really big, apparently really big label, and I think we signed it to them in like a November, and it came out the following August. We'd forgotten about it by that point. The whole genre, this was a, as the genre that I was in at the time was changing, me and this guy dabbled in this new style or whatever, and decided, you know, we did this track, it got signed, great. And then we sort of, both of us individually and separately, went, yeah, it's not for us, we'll go in this direction. And then, you know, a year later, this track came out, and I was like, oh shit, I forgot I even signed that, and was almost embarrassed at the track. Luckily, this big label was run by a bunch of idiots who are just clearly money grabbing and pushing stuff out, and so it didn't really do very well, and I'm quite glad that it didn't do well, to be honest, partly because the idiots running the label don't deserve the money, and second of all, because I was kind of embarrassed of the track. So but in terms of collaborations, I think it's always a bit difficult. And also, you know, I guess, you know, all of us as producers kind of work in our own style and have our own unique features in a track. And sometimes it's quite hard to sort of join those features. So if I was going to collaborate with someone right now, there are a few out there that I'm technically currently collaborating with. Whether they get released or not is another thing. So it's kind of a tricky one. Dan C. Hi Dom, hi. Just found your series on YouTube and it's definitely very interesting. Thank you very much. My question is, what production / musical quality in a track is sought after by labels right now? Thanks. That's a very good question and almost impossible to answer. The only way to really know is, and I hate to say this, but if you go somewhere like Beatport and then go down to genre and maybe look at, you know, the top 100 chart and see which labels are doing particularly well, and then listen to all of their latest releases, and then you can kind of judge where things are going. However, it's also worth mentioning, with a lot of the big labels, their schedules are pretty packed, so sometimes they are changing angle, and that's why you need to talk to record labels more than just spam the shit out of them. Because if you start a conversation with a label or an A&R manager, then they'll hopefully be able to guide you in, or at least let you know in what direction they think they might be moving, if they're moving anywhere at all. However, it's probably worth saying, because I'm signed to Mau5trap, and Mau5trap are kind of known for not really sticking to one genre. In fact, they put out a promo last night. I don't know if I even saw an artist's name, but there's an EP coming out next week. It's on their Facebook and probably YouTube. And it was big, raucous American dubstep stuff. So, yeah, you know, and bearing in mind my stuff is more sort of deep, ploddy, progressive, and then you've got people like No Mana that's the sort of 8-bit techno stuff. So, yeah, so they kind of release a bit of everything. But so I guess it's kind of tricky when it comes to, maybe you can't nail it down to genres, but as for sort of production musical quality, it's really difficult to judge. I mean, I guess base level, I guess what you need, you all need to do as producers, and myself included, I still do this. You need to finish, get the mixed and mastered version of your own track, and then DJ with it. It only needs to be at home on headphones. It doesn't need to be perfectly beat matched. You don't need to be a good DJ or anything like that, but you need to develop a set, I suppose, you know, even if that's just three or four tracks of, say, your favourite artist that you think are a similar style, and, you know, in Ableton, Bitwig, whatever, maybe mix them together and mix from one to the other and put your track in the middle of that three-track set or whatever, mix from something similar into yours and then from yours into something similar again, and then listen to it from start to finish as a whole and ask yourself, does this fit? Does this work? Because you might find that, and this helps with things like mixing and stuff as well, anyway, with your mix down mixing, because you might find your kick drums aren't cutting through the other track, or your melody doesn't, or it's just quiet, or maybe you thought your track was really techno-y, but when you play it amongst other big techno tracks, you might find, oh shit, that sounds weak as shit. But if you played it against some more progressive tracks, then it suddenly sounds more techno-y. And I guess it's about finding a place there. But it helps for you to sort of judge the quality of your own track as well. It's kind of like a quality testing, I suppose. As for other labels, and do you know what? There are so many labels out there doing so many things that I don't think there is one thing. So even though I feel like I'm not answering your question, I think that is the answer. And the biggest thing you can do is develop a relationship with a record label. A working relationship is worth more than anything with a record label. You need to know what the person behind that record label is like and what their interests are in terms of music and musicality, because ultimately they're the people that release your music, and more importantly, the more they like your track, the more energy and commitment they're going to put into both you as an artist and that track as a release. And I think that's hugely important, and I think that's something that a lot of people forget these days, is that, in fact, going back to this remix I was just talking about, the shit one that got released by a shit label, you know, clearly those guys were just the playing numbers games. They just release loads of tracks every week, and don't get me wrong, they've got probably a top 10 DJ in the world as the name of the label, as the face of the label. It's supposedly his label. I doubt he listens to what gets put out on it, but they're kind of running off the back of that and just throwing crap out there, and proof of that was that they signed this track that ultimately probably shouldn't have been released, and that's partly my fault, was that I probably didn't do that quality control, but also they were so far ahead in their schedule that they're just stacking tracks up and releasing them as and when they feel like it or whatever it is, and getting out a backlog. And there's no real sort of thought process behind it. Whereas, if, for example, you know, I've worked with some smaller labels where the A&R person behind the label has gone, holy shit, this is brilliant. I love this track. I love what you're doing as an artist. I can totally see this fitting in a place, doing a thing. And it's those situations where that person will then maybe put some money up front for some decent promo or some decent marketing, or we'll make sure that that track gets in the hands of some big DJs, or, you know, goes into as many podcasts or whatever their promotional thing is. I don't run a label anymore, so I don't know what the done thing is these days, but that's more important than anything. So I, you know, it's weird, as artists we kind of need to think of record labels as our quality control as well, and we need to work with a label that offers good quality control. They need to because otherwise they're just a distributor. And you know, I've mentioned this before, where you talk about self-releasing and stuff like that. Well, if you're working with a record label that's not offering you any more than just a self-release, you may as well just self-release, because there's no advantage to not doing it, and you own your own copyright then. So if you're ever going to release with a label, there needs to be that relationship there, and you need to be able to, you know, they should be able to do something for you. It's not just you doing something for them. It's a two-way street, and always should be. So yeah, I think I've waffled a lot on that. Cheers. Spectre Beats. Hey Dom, how many times can someone ask for feedback to know an art to a known artist, I think that is, before becoming obnoxious, asking for a friend? Good question. Oh, I can say there's more. Also, come on, high five. Oh. yeah, that's kind of a tricky one. A lot of people ask me for feedback on tracks, and I've got to be honest, I struggle with that. As for really famous artists and stuff, I dread to think how many they get sent, so it's kind of tricky. Sometimes I genuinely forget, because I'm in the UK time zone, so this is one tip: look at what time zone that artist is in. That probably makes a difference, and if you can work out what hours they're working, makes a difference as well. So for me, I'm in the UK, I tend to work between say 8 a.m. and 7 p.m. ish. If you send me a track on my Facebook fan page, for example, where I get sent a lot and asked for feedback, first of all, if you're sending it after 7 p.m. my time, I might open the message and then forget about it by the next day, and I'm working the next day, and I've not thought about it. So I'm not ignoring you. I just wasn't, you know, I could be watching TV or out in a restaurant or meeting with friends in the evening. And if you've sent me a track and I've just quickly looked at the message, it's not going to notify me of that again. So there's going to be a lot of times where I think, oh, I'll check that tomorrow. And then, of course, tomorrow comes along and I've forgotten. So to any of you watching this, if you've sent me tracks and I've not responded, I apologise profusely, but that's usually the reason why. If I'm sat in front of the computer and I'm just kind of killing time and you send one to me, then I'll pretty much listen to it straight away if I can, if I see it come through. And I will usually offer some feedback. But this is the other catch-all, kind of catch-22 thing, is that I need a bit more information on what feedback you want sometimes as well. I think that's a tricky one, because you could send me a track that could be the greatest track ever written, but just not my thing. It's not my genre, it's not my area of whatever. And I wouldn't want to come back to you going, it's not my thing, and be all dismissive, and you then think, oh, well, that guy's a twat, when it just might not be right for me. So I think that's kind of tricky. And at the same time as well, if I don't know you as a person, and you all need to bear this in mind when you're sending tracks to producers, it's kind of catch 22 again from your end, because we don't know who you are necessarily. So we don't know if you've been producing for 6 months. So let's say somebody sent me a track that sounded, by my standards of knowing big producers and big productions, I could think a track is terrible. But if it turned out you'd only been producing for 2 weeks and that was your first ever go, then I could be going, holy shit, this is great for a first effort. So without that context, I think that's quite tricky. So I would say only ever send music to an artist like myself or whatever, only send a track to me if you think it deserves being signed and released and given good promotion. And I know that's kind of tricky to judge, and maybe that's the feedback you want, is it ready or not? But if you can try and sort of gauge at that level, because anything below that level, I think you need to rely on your close personal friends and family or people you know that are similar to you or something like that, because without that context it becomes very difficult for any artist to gauge what that person really wants in terms of feedback. So it's kind of tricky. If I'm brutally honest, I would say most of the time there's probably no point in sending a track to an artist, maybe myself included at times, partly because I just don't have much time to do these things, and I wish I could do it more often. And I have said to anyone who wants to send me a track and get full feedback, then head to audiu.net, audiu.net, and find me there, because it's a paid system where I'm gonna go, right, this will take me an hour, I will listen to it 5 times from start to finish, and I will give you constructive feedback on anything from your hi-hats, your kick drums, your melody, the arrangement, the mix and master, the use of effects, the originality, the market appeal. If you want full feedback like that, then go somewhere like Audio. You don't have to use me, of course, you can use anyone you want, but go somewhere like that for good, substantive feedback. But aside from that, you know, so again, it's kind of tricky, I think, for myself and pretty much every artist I know at my level or above. You know, a lot of the time they want to give feedback, but you can't be too honest. It's kind of tricky because unless the track's massive, unless you're sending us an absolute hit, then obviously we're going to be honest. But if you're sending us something that's not really our thing, then it's really difficult to say that without either coming across as a dick or just being completely ignorant to the context. So yeah, again, I'm ranting here, but I feel like I am, but I'm trying to sort of be as honest as I can and give as much advice as I can, because actually I think, you know, if I had a couple of big tracks that I'd just done and I thought, do you know what, this could be something big, there's like a select maybe 5 or 6 world famous DJs that I regularly speak to that I would send it to, and then I'd maybe send it to 2 or 3 big name artists that maybe I haven't really spoken to or met in real life. But beyond that, there's hundreds of DJs that I would love to have playing my music, but I kind of figure that's maybe more the responsibility of a record label to get it into those hands, rather than me to do it directly, unless I know the artist. So I think asking for feedback from a well-known artist is kind of a bit of a controversial point, because there's a lot of reasons to do it, so I'm not saying don't ever do it, but there's also a lot of reasons not to do it. And if you're gonna do it, then there's a whole load of terms and conditions that come with it. So going back to your original question, how many times can someone ask for feedback? So for me personally, I mean, I would say send it the first time, maybe give me one sentence of context, like, I've been doing this for 3 months and not sure if I'm ready to release, or I've been doing this for 10 years and this is my 3 millionth track, or whatever, something like that. And then if you don't get a response, if I don't even see the message, then probably not much point in sending another one, maybe again in a month or something. But if I do see the message, so for me personally, if I see the message on a British evening and then you don't hear back from me for a few days, then I've probably forgotten about it and missed it, and then just send a little nudge, basically, asking if I got it or whatever. But try and do that at a different time of day. If you first sent it to me in the evening, then maybe do it in the morning a couple of days later or something. because that's usually when I go, oh shit, yeah, that, I forgot about that. And I'm trying to think now, there's probably like 20 in my Facebook page inbox that I've done that to within the last week or two. So, you know, they do stack up, and then it turns into like, you know, so those, of those 20, for example, if I was gonna go back to those right now, I'm looking at probably an hour's work. So you have to kind of bear that in mind as well. So again, it depends on who you're talking to, but obviously the bigger the producer, the more they're going to have these things. So, you know, if you think of people like Deadmau5, for example, I mean, it's no wonder he kind of shuts down his social media with stuff like that. I dread to think how much he gets. Talking to Mitch, I can see his name coming up. Zombo, hi Dom, in Deadmau5 Masterclass, he tells a bit about how in a festival, the main band gets an extra 3 dB gain. And what is the job of a front of house mixer? Again, a good question. Yeah, that always kind of bothers me. I don't know if it's, well, it's, no, it's going to be true for some festivals, not all festivals. Actually, no, most festivals, yeah, they probably do get a fair bit of extra gain. What really bothers me is like arena gigs, when you get the warm-up bands. You'll have all seen this if you've been to any arena gig, or just a big venue, like rock bands and stuff especially. It really bothers me that the 3-4 warm-up bands gradually get louder and better quality, and it pisses me off because a lot of that comes down to front of house mixing. So in terms of what is the job of front of house mixers, it is to essentially control the balance. Essentially what you're doing is you're doing a mix down in real time. That's basically what you're doing. So you need, you know, the snares and kicks to be roughly level with, you know, the vocals and the bass. You're probably listening through headphones or just general speakers and making a judgment. That will be mostly kind of pre-planned anyway. You'll have done rehearsals and warm-ups and whatever anyway, so you know you've got the settings saved, so you're not doing a complete mix down from scratch. But it's your job to sort of look after that basically, and then steadily increase the volume as the night goes on. I understand why they do it, because if you go to see a band and the headline act is on at say 9 p.m, you know, the few bands before that, you want that 9 p.m. moment to be as big as you possibly can. So a lot of that comes down to the front of house. They'll boost the gains, they'll use the main hall speakers as well as their own sound system and whatever. Everything's on, you know, full ramp then. I can see my camera's about to cut out again. Today's going to be long, sorry, but let me reset. Yeah, so yeah, with the front of house, they're basically starting on, you know, you'll get the very first warm-up band when everyone's just kind of piling into the venue, and they're pretty much on their own guitar amps and a live drum kit and not much amplification, whereas then the next band comes on and you'll have a bit more amps and whatever, and it just increases, and then the main act comes on. So as a ticket buying fan of these bands, it gets louder and more exciting and everything's great, and for the headline act, everything's, you know, full stage show, all the lights are running, all the amps are running at peak. And that makes it a great experience. However, as somebody who enjoys listening to new unheard music and bands, I always feel bad for the warm-up bands, because I think, well, how are they supposed to be loved and growing new fans in this event when they're being shoved on a shitty sound system and they're not being appreciated properly by the engineers? So how can they then be appreciated by the fans? To me, it doesn't quite make sense. I get that you want the experience to build, so by all means do it to a certain level, but sometimes you get to a venue and, you know, the warm-up band are given a completely shit sound system, and I think that's unfair. But who am I? I can't change it. So yeah, that's kind of the job of the front house mixers. The other difference, of course, is that for the warm-up bands, you know, and this is another big difference, the warm-up bands are not paying for the show. In fact, sometimes they're quite literally paying to play their own gig when you're warming up for a huge headline act that is pop and not involved in the industry, then you're quite often paying and some serious money. I've seen some bands pay in excess of 20, 30 grand to be able to play three dates with a superstar. You kind of make that back in PRS royalties or ASCAP if you're in America, but rarely. Anyway, that's a whole different thing. But the other thing, so the other thing I was trying to mention with this front of house mixing is that the headline act usually have their own front of house engineers and their own sound system and their own lights and their own staging, and they're really the guys paying for the whole event. So again, I suppose, you know, if you want to play fair, then that is kind of fair that they get the extra gain, and that they're the reason people are there, they're the reason people are buying tickets. So I get all of that. It just seems a little that sometimes it's a bit too split up. And you know, if you compare the first band of the night to the headline act, it can be just different worlds, which I think is where it gets a bit unfair. You know, getting an extra few dB here and there is fine. And I'm sure I haven't seen Deadmau5's masterclass. I don't tend to follow him in any big way, to be honest. But I should imagine, you know, if he's talking about that in his masterclass, it probably is. I mean, he's obviously right in whatever he says, because that's his experience. But, you know, for him, I suppose he's amongst other nearly headline acts. So, yeah, it probably is just about 3 dB extra gain for him, because he is amongst other people of a similar stature, I guess. Whereas the venues I'm talking about is like, so I'll give you an example. I went to see The Slaves, and that's probably a good example. I saw them in Cardiff a couple of years ago, and all through the night I was thinking, God, this sound system's terrible. I hadn't been to that venue before. I think it was the Students Union or something, and I was thinking, oh, the venue's not very good, it's all a bit echoey, and the sound system was a bit shit, and I could barely hear the first band, and it wasn't a huge venue. And then it sort of steadily got better, and then the one band before Slaves, all of a sudden the quality just went up 100 levels, and I thought, oh, they've just switched on the main speakers of the venue. And then obviously Slaves came on and it was the whole system, and then I thought, well, this sounds incredible now. Why? And there's only two guys in Slaves, it's only a guitarist and a drummer, so why all of a sudden does it sound like, you know, 100 times louder and bigger and richer than all the other sort of six-piece bands? And I kind of felt bad for all the warm-up acts that were probably not getting paid very much to be there, and their names, and this is another bugbear, I'm going to go on a rant here briefly, but this one really bugs me. So when I bought those tickets, for example, and it says Slaves, it doesn't mention the warm-up bands, there's no name, and some of these people are paying to, I'm not saying this particular gig because I don't know and I doubt it, but like I mentioned earlier, some bands will pay huge amounts of money to get onto the tour, and they don't even have their name printed on the ticket or the poster or anything like that. So when people are talking about, oh yeah, but it's good exposure, where's the exposure in that? There's no exposure. You're not getting your name printed on the flyer or the ticket stubs or anything like that. And what really bugs me with that is I've gone to see a lot of bands where that happens, and maybe band number two or three, I'll go, these guys are great, I'll remember their name, and of course the next day I've forgotten the name, and it's not on the ticket stub, it's not on the poster or whatever, so I've got no way of finding out. And sometimes they say the name of their own band before or after their set, and you can't hear them properly, so you don't even know what they said their name was, and they told you, you know. So yeah, stuff like that really bothers me, more so than just an extra 3 dB again. I don't think there's anything wrong with just an extra 3 dB again for the headline act. So yeah, end of ramp there. And I think that is it. We've got Yanis Lukmelis. By the way, correct me if it's Yanis and not if it's Janis and not Yanis. I have no idea of what origin you are. Command, high five. And then Reality on X Production, command, high five. And that, my friends, is it for today. It feels like it's been quite a long one today, she said. So thank you very much for listening this far in. Again, I really deserve a medal because I feel like I've just ranted today. So thanks for listening. And if you have made it this far in, then comment the keyword. Let's get it from a recommended video. I want a word. I always look for a word that I think hopefully most people around the world can spell. Tesla. In fact, the Tesla Model Y event was yesterday. I'm going to open that in a new tab because I want to see that new Tesla. So there we go. If you've made it this far into the video, comment the word Tesla to let me know and you'll get a high five in the next one. Yeah, as always, I do love these questions coming in, so please do comment below. And I never say this, but I should every time. Like, comment, subscribe, get involved. Please do share these videos because the more people see them, the more new questions I'm going to get. And that makes everything awesome for everyone. So yeah, thank you very much. Have a good weekend and I'll see you this time next week. Cheers.